Hello everyone and welcome to the first lecture of the course Energy Engineering. I am Swapnil Prakash Aute, working as an associate professor in Department of Mechanical Engineering in Maratha Vidya Prasarak Samaj, Karmavir Advocate Baburao Ganpatrao Thakre College of Engineering, Nashik. Since this is the first lecture, let me introduce myself briefly. I obtained my doctoral degree from IIT Bombay in Thermal and Fluid Engineering. My specializations are IC Engine Combustion and Automobile Engineering. I have total professional experience of 14 years, out of which 1 year was in Research and Development Department of Larsen & Toubro Limited, Mumbai. 3 years in Research and Development Department of Mahindra & Mahindra Limited, Nashik. And from last 10 years, I am teaching engineering undergraduate students. The name of the course which we are going to study is Energy Engineering, and as per Savitribai Phule Pune University 2015 pattern, the code of the course is 402047. As far as exam scheme is concerned, for this course there will be a theory exam of 100 marks, which is split into in semester exam of 30 marks and end semester examination of 70 marks. Students are expected to complete around 8 experiments, and they are expected to write a journal based on those 8 experiments, which have to be submitted as a part of term work that will be carrying 25 marks. At the end of the semester, an oral examination will be conducted based on this term work, which will be carrying 25 marks. Prerequisites, which means knowledge of these subjects, will be required prior to studying energy engineering. These subjects are thermodynamics 1, thermodynamics 2, and heat transfer. As far as course contents are concerned, the entire course curriculum is divided into 6 units. First unit is introduction of this subject to the students and thermal power plant. Unit 2 will be pertaining to steam condenser and environmental impacts of thermal power plant. Unit 3 is focusing on hydroelectric and nuclear power plants. Unit 4 will be covering diesel and gas turbine power plant. Unit 5 is about non-conventional power plants. So you can see first 5 units are about studying various types of power plants, and unit 6 is dedicated to the instrumentation and economics of power plant. Since we are following outcome-based education and the guidelines of the same are received as per Washington Accord, these subjects has to achieve certain course outcomes, and to know these course outcomes in the first lecture itself is very important, because it will give perspective to the students that why we are learning this course and what are the skills which students are expected to achieve after completion of this course. So after completion of the course, students will be able to describe power generation scenario and analyze Rankine cycle and cogeneration cycle. They will be able to analyze steam condensers and illustrate the methods to control environmental impact of thermal power plant, analyze hydroelectric power plant and explain nuclear power plant, analyze the performance of diesel power plant and gas power plant, discuss various non-conventional power plants, and finally describe power plant instruments, and they should be able to estimate the power plant economics. So you can understand all these 6 units are helping us to achieve these 6 course outcomes. After we achieve these 6 course outcomes by learning these subjects, we have to see which program outcomes we will be achieving through this subject. As you might be aware that there are 12 program outcomes which are based on 12 graduate attributes given by the same Washington Accord, out of which around 7 program outcomes are achieved after learning this course Energy Engineering. These program outcomes are students will be able to apply engineering knowledge after learning this subject. They will be able to analyze the problems in the field of energy and especially in the field of power generation. They should be able to apply the knowledge for the benefit of society and understand their role in the society. They should be able to come up with environmental friendly solutions and which are sustainable as well. Students will function as an individual and teamwork in a better manner after learning this course. They should be able to communicate their learnings in effective manner, and student will be able to imbibe the habit of lifelong learning after learning these subjects. So based on this background, I hope you are in a position to understand the importance of these subjects in the scheme of mechanical engineering graduate. So let us start discussing the various aspects of this subject unit by unit. So let us begin with unit number one, which is introduction and thermal power plants. And the first topic for this lecture is world energy scenario. You can see two pie charts. Let us focus on the pie chart on the left hand side. It is depicting world total primary energy supply by fuel in the year 2018. Total primary energy supply is abbreviated as TPES. So contribution of various fuel is depicted in this particular diagram, and it can be observed that the highest contribution for energy comes from oil, which stands at around 34%, followed by coal and natural gas, which means most of the energy in the world is obtained from oil, then by coal, and then from natural gas. The least contribution is obtained from the other renewable energy sources and nuclear sources, which stands at 4%. The second pie chart is depicting world total final consumption of energy by various sectors. So total final consumption is abbreviated as TFC. And the total final consumption is around 119.8 picowatt-hour, and its distribution in various sectors is given in this particular pie chart. So on the left hand side we have got the supply side, and on the right hand side we have got the consumption side, so that we can make out where all this energy is going. So it can be observed in the pie chart that the highest consumption takes place in industries, which is at around 54% of this 119 picowatt hour of energy, which is followed by the energy consumed in transportation and for residential purposes. The lowest consumer of energy is energy utilized for commercial applications, which stands at 7%. So you can understand the highest contributor is oil and the highest consumer is industrial, and that is the reason why oil is considered so precious in modern economy. Again, the pie chart on the left is representing world TFC of 9717 metric ton of oil equivalent by region in 2017, and these statistics which we are seeing in these lectures are obtained from International Energy Agency and their report, which was published in the year 2019. So these are all reasonably latest values, and the total consumption is expressed as 9717 metric ton of oil equivalent. So you have to understand this unit as well. Since energy is obtained from different sources, if we want to add energy from various sources, then we have to have a uniform unit, and all the energy is converted into the oil equivalent and then added together. So let us see by region what is the consumption of the energy. So the most startling observation in this graph is around 29% of the energy in the world is consumed by a single country, that is China, which is followed by rest of Asia and OECD. Now, although China is part of Asia, since the consumption of China itself is so high, as it is considered as a single country, it is depicted separately in this pie chart. So rest of the Asia is 19% and OECD is 12%. OECD stands for Organization of Economical Cooperation and Development. So basically these are OECD countries are the developed countries, which are like Canada, USA, most of the European countries, Australia, Japan, and South Korea. So almost more than 50% of world's energy is consumed by these three regions: China, rest of Asia, and OECD. It can be seen that the least consumption is from the aviation and marine bunkers, which stands at 6%. Now, this is not a region, but these are kind of a neutral region in the global geography, and they consume around 6% of the total world energy. As far as regions are concerned, non-OECD countries in the American continent and Middle East are having the least consumption of total energy available in the world. On the right-hand side, we have 2018 world electricity generation by source. Again, the statistics is from the same report. So this pie chart is depicting the distribution of electricity generation on the basis of the source used for the electricity generation. Now, the difference between this graph and the first pie chart is that the first pie chart is about the total energy supply in the world. So, and this is only electricity generation. So electricity generation is included in the first pie chart, which we have already seen. And this particular pie chart is focusing only on the electricity generation. So it can be observed from this pie chart that the highest contribution as a source comes from coal, which is 38% for electricity generation, and it is followed by the gas and hydro and other energy sources. So it again puts a lot of emphasis on the importance of coal. So some of us might be under the impression that oil is the most important fuel, but if you see this graph, the contribution of oil for electricity generation is least, standing at 3%. However, if you recollect the first pie chart, that distribution of total primary energy supply by fuel, oil is the largest contributor. So we have to understand the difference between these two graphs, which means most of the oil which is being supplied in the world is consumed in transportation purposes instead of electricity generation. As far as electricity generation is concerned, the highest contribution comes from the coal and not from the oil. Oil is the most popular fuel in transportation applications. This is an interesting graph which is representing electricity generation by fuel in G20 countries in the year 2017. So on y-axis we have names of these G20 countries, and on the x-axis we have share of various fuel in energy generation of that particular country. So let us try to understand this graph in detail. The contribution of coal is shown by brown colored bars. So if we want to pick the countries which have got the highest dependency or who are developing who are generating most of the electricity from coal, then we can say South Africa, then India and China are three countries, top three countries, which are generating most of their electricity from coal. Then the second source is natural gas, depicted by the light blue colored bars, and we can see Saudi Arabia, then Mexico, Argentina are some of the countries who generate most of their electricity from natural gases. As far as dependency on oil is concerned, again Saudi Arabia is the highest. It is developing as far as use of oil in electricity generation is concerned, it stands at the top in the world, and which is obvious because we all know that Saudi Arabia has large oil reserves in its area, so which is quite obvious. Then the nuclear energy is depicted by yellow colored, and France can be seen to have a large advantage over here because most of the electricity in France is generated from nuclear power. Even no other country is even close to France as far as generation of nuclear energy is concerned. And lastly, the sky blue color is indicating the share of energy developed from hydroelectric power plants, and if we see the most of the electricity generated in Canada and Brazil is from hydroelectricity. So what one can understand from this graph is that every country is trying to harness its potential, harness its resources to the maximum extent. And whichever fuel is cheaply available and abundantly available in that country is used to generate the electricity in that particular country. At the same time, it is also important to see that these countries have got the technology, relevant technology available with them to harness those resources into the electricity generation. For example, France has got the technology to harness the nuclear power generation. So you can see France is leading as far as nuclear power generation is concerned. So that's why I'm saying it's a very interesting graph as far as dependency of each country on different fuels as far as electricity generation is concerned is depicted over here. This is the graph of comparison of populations without energy access for the period between 1985 to 2018. So this is period of almost 23 years. So you can see on the y-axis we have got the population without energy access, and it is mentioned in millions of people, and on x-axis we have got the timeline from 1985 to 2018. Again, this population is distributed region wise. So green indicating India, red indicating China, orange sub-Saharan Africa, and blue rest of the world. The major trend, if you see in this graph, is that the population without energy access is monotonously reducing over the period of time, which is a good thing. Moreover, the population without energy access in China is almost zero from the year 2000 onwards. And in all the regions, the population without energy access is continuously reducing. However, if we observe these orange colored bars, you'll realize that the population without energy access is not reducing in sub-Saharan Africa, and there lies a scope of improvement as far as engineers working in the energy engineering is concerned. So this was about the world energy scenario, and in the next lecture we will learn about the energy scenario in India. Meanwhile, you are expected to answer these quiz questions. The answers of these questions will be lying somewhere in this video itself, so you have to go through this video once again and find the answer. The first question is, which country has the highest contribution of renewable resources in electricity generation? The second question is, why highest total final consumption is reported in China? Answer to these questions will be declared in the next lecture video. Till then, you are expected to find it out. Thank you.